Before we dive in, can you give a self-intro about what you do at Nvidia?
Hi, I'm Ethan. I'm a deep learning engineer at Nvidia. I work on large language model training and scaling transformers to large scale, including mixture of experts.
Some of us might not get familiar with the term mixture of experts, so do you mind give us a quick overview?
You can think of like it's a single model, but it combines several models together. Depending on what your question is, it selectively activates some of the expert to answer your question. You might have heard of Llama models, GPT models already. Most of these models are dense model. All of the neurons are mostly activated in the model inference. That's why they are called dense. However, for a mixture of expert, on the other hand, they are sparsely activated model. That means whenever you give it a query, only part of the model is activated.
Okay, cool. So what's the algorithm usually used to decide which expert to activate?
The thing used for selecting expert is called a router. The router is simply a very small neural network that can decide which expert to activate during the inference. Based on your input, it will generate a probability distribution over the number of experts. Then it selects the top K experts to answer a question.
Each expert will take care of a different field or like a different aspect of the model, or?
Not exactly. So there are some people who try to interpret whether each expert will learn something different, but neural networks are known to learn this entangled knowledge. So it's very hard to tell like which field this expert is learning.
So it's not like, oh, this agent or this expert studies math and the other one studies art. It's not like that.
Right. There are some basic ones where some expert would focus on like within token generalizations, some focus on cross tokens.
Cross tokens?
Yeah, like relationship between tokens.
So what's the main advantage compared to, I guess, traditional methods to build LLMs?
So mixture of expert allows scaling the models to the next level. Let's say the Llama model, the biggest model they scaled is to 405B. Like if you want to scale the model beyond that, you either need a lot more GPUs or you can use a mix of experts. Like you can scale the same Llama 405B up to like 2 trillion parameters without significantly increasing the compute.
Ah, I see. So who in the industry will need such upcycling or building larger LLMs with MoE?
I'd say almost everyone will need it. It will be an essential technique, no matter small company or bigger company. For bigger companies like OpenAI, they've already served the GPT-4, which is rumored to be a MoE model. MoE is much more efficient at large scale because the model is sparsely activated, you save more money. And for smaller companies, you save more money training them rather than like training a dense model. I'd say this will become a standard for building large language models.
So we're going to dive deeper into the paper you and your team has just published. What kind of problem is your paper trying to solve?
Yeah, we are trying to solve upcycling at a large scale. Upcycling means instead of training an MoE from scratch, you upcycle the existing dense model and then train like a few thousands or hundreds of thousands more iterations to make a better model.
Is your paper going to be productionized?
It's already in our open source project Megatron Core. So we have the functionality to upcycle large language models into bigger ones. You can find it on GitHub.
So if today someone wants to train MoE with upcycling, then they can go to the GitHub repo, right?
Exactly.
It's awesome. Now I think it's a good time to dive into more technical details of the paper. You experimented with different parameters such as learning rate and the batch size.
So we found very interesting that MoEs need lower learning rate and a higher batch size. This is because experts are sparsely activated. Each expert actually receives fewer tokens, which is fewer batch size during training. That's why you need the larger batch size.
How about the load balancing? Like, how does it add to the experiments?
Load balancing is to ensure the MoE evenly distributes tokens among its experts. We found that the less load balancing, the better. You want the model to learn like how to distribute the tokens by itself. They'll make sure there's no data experts that receive their tokens.
And in your paper, you also mentioned the word granularity. Can you explain what it is and how does that affect the results of the training?
Granularity is basically segment the experts into smaller ones. So this creates more experts than like the typical 8-expert scheme. This provides more flexibility and provides better accuracy.
I see. So imagine like we have more experts. Does that mean that the model will perform better?
Yes, but up to a limit. We have tests like up to 200 experts, it still helps, but beyond that, it becomes difficult for the model to learn like which expert to route to.
In your paper, you also mentioned the concept of shared experts. What does it mean?
Yeah, shared expert means some experts are always activated. However, usually the experts are chosen based on the probability. Let's say the probability is the highest, we'll choose it. Lower, they wouldn't choose it. But these shared experts are always active. They're meant to learn things in common among different domains.
And is there something that you find surprising during experiments?
Interesting thing we found are like the MoEs are pretty hard to train efficiently, especially at large scale. Like you need to do a lot of engineering optimization to train these models efficiently, like beyond like 7B, 15B.
By the way, like how many GPUs do you need to conduct those experiments?
In this paper, we use 0.3 UTFLOPS. It translates to roughly like 500 GPUs for a week.
I guess that we talked a lot about the good stuff about upcycling MoE. So are there some limitations or drawbacks?
So the drawback is the benefit itself, I think. Like upcycling apply to where you have an existing dense model and you want to adapt it into MoE. If you don't have a good dense model, then upcycling is a useless technique. For example, there's no like a good existing Mamba model right now, so it's hard to apply upcycling to Mamba.
What do you look forward to in the field of the research of MoE?
I look forward to larger and larger models, because so far the biggest models rumored so far is the 1.8 trillion parameters GPT-4 MoE. I think there can be larger ones. Let's see if there's any in the future.